You're listening to 106.2 FM IDC International Radio. I'm Itai Hanman, joined in studio today with Mr. Brian Jenkins, who is the senior advisor to the president of the RAND Corporation, is the author of Will Terrorists Go Nuclear, a book back in 2008, and several RAND monographs, including Unconquerable Nation, Knowing Our Enemy, Strengthening Ourselves, and two 2002 reports on Al-Qaeda. He is also, Mr. Jenkins is also working with the Transportation Board and making sure our safety on different transportation hubs around the world and specifically in the United States. Mr. Jenkins, how are you doing today?
I'm doing fine. Thank you.
Thank you for taking the time to join us today here at Unpuzzling Terrorism, a show where MA students are given the opportunity to ask the experts in the field of counterterrorism really how things are going. And we're joined today with Evan Weinberg, who is one of the MA students in the program here at the IDC. Hi, Evan.
Hey, pleasure to be here.
Excellent stuff. We're going to delve right into this, Mr. Jenkins, and ask you, you are one of the pioneers of the field of counterterrorism, both academically and as a practitioner, as you were in the military already at the age of 19. Maybe give us a little bit of your background in history on how you got to this point in your career.
You know, it was actually never planned that way. In fact, I probably have to admit to being a fraud. My undergraduate degree is in fine arts as a painter. My graduate degrees are in history and another one in humanities. So it's an 18th century education. But I was commissioned in the military, in the infantry, and at 19 I served all of my active duty time in special forces in Latin America and Southeast Asia during the war in Vietnam, and went directly from the military to the RAND Corporation, where when I joined RAND staff at the beginning of 1972, I wrote a memorandum based upon my experience in Asia and in Latin America, and based upon really the headlines of the moment, that this problem of terrorism, international terrorism, was likely to become increasingly international, was likely to increase in terms of its volume as a problem for us, and could affect the United States in a variety of ways, and laid out some of the policy issues and some of the things that we ought to be looking at. That memo went off to Washington to some great elephant burial ground of memoranda, and nothing was heard until two particularly shocking episodes in 1972. One took place here in Israel, and that was in May 1972, what was called the Lod Airport Massacre. This is where three Japanese terrorists, members of the Japanese Red Army, which was in alliance with the Popular Front for the Liberation of Palestine, came off of one plane, took out automatic weapons and hand grenades, and attacked passengers on an arriving TWA flight from the United States, many of whom happened to be Puerto Rican pilgrims visiting the Holy Land. And it wasn't simply the slaughter. There were about 30 killed, about 80 who were wounded. But the complexity of it, people asked, how is it that Japanese come to Israel to kill Puerto Ricans on behalf of Palestinians? Then in September, of course, the Munich incident, in which hundreds of millions of people around the world watched this terrible event of Black September taking members of the Israeli team hostage, and that ended tragically. Those two incidents acted as a catalyst for a number of governments, including the United States, to, in a sense, get their acts together and begin to think more seriously about this. In the United States, it led to the creation of something called the Cabinet Committee to Combat Terrorism, which was chaired by the Secretary of State and had the Secretary of Defense, the head of the CIA, the Attorney General, and so on. It was someone on that committee that then stumbled across this old memorandum I had written and said, oh, well, there's some fellow out at the RAND Corporation. Why don't we ask them to initiate research? And so at the in the fall of 1972, we began a research project that has continued till this day.
That's quite, it dates back quite a bit, and it shows also in that sense that how far have we come since those two incidents specifically, and what have we learned? So in your opinion, since being asked to begin that research and where you're at today in 2016, how far along has the governments of the West come and society come in realizing and then, I guess, combating the issue of terrorism?
Well, clearly the phenomenon itself has changed over the years. Terrorists have increased the volume of terrorist violence. So whereas these were occasional events in the 1970s, they are now unfortunately a regular feature, a mode of political expression, a mode of armed conflict in the world. Second, terrorists have escalated their violence. The worst incidents of terrorism in the 1970s were measured in tens of fatalities. In the 1980s, this ascended to hundreds of fatalities. Of course, on 9/11, it ascended into the thousands of fatalities. That's an order of magnitude increase about every 10 or 15 years. And that has had dramatic impact and has changed how we, that is the countries faced with this problem, have to deal with it. Initially, we looked at terrorism through the framework of the single incident, and it wasn't that the United States, for example, was going to engage every terrorist organization around the world. It was rather that we wanted to criminalize specific tactics that were outlawed in war and certainly should not be permitted outside of war. So taking hostages, kidnappings, attacks on commercial aviation, going after diplomats, things of this sort. But over a period of time, those were useful in building an international consensus, but it didn't stop terrorism. And as I say, terrorist violence escalated. And over the years, increasingly, terrorism has become a war in which we are determined to destroy the terrorist organizations themselves. And the United States has, of course, since 2001, been engaged in combat operations in Afghanistan, in Iraq, not initially for the purpose of terrorism, but it turned into a counter-terrorist campaign and continues to be engaged in Iraq and Syria today and in other countries, in Somalia and elsewhere, in combating this. So this is an ongoing struggle that has become a major issue. So from kind of a sideshow in the 1970s, a sideshow to the Cold War, this is now a major component, many would say the major component, of national security and homeland security.
Professor Jenkins, you've recently written an article about checkpoints in Europe, and you say that establishing new checkpoints or security fences or stuff like that is not the answer to every new terrorist attack. In Europe now, with the Schengen zone, people can travel freely anywhere they want without being stopped, without the authorities knowing where they are. In response to this, and in conjunction with your article, do you think that changes need to be made to this security perimeter? Do you think that we can afford to keep the Schengen zone the same as it is today?
Well, you know, the article really was focusing on the issue of whether or not the security perimeter should be extended from the checkpoints that we go through before we board aircraft, and should there be an additional ring of checkpoints to protect the airport terminal itself. And some things are done at the entrance to the airports. There are checkpoints. But the idea of protecting public spaces is extremely difficult. And if we look at some of the recent attacks, for example, that have occurred in Europe, not just airports, but airports, subways, restaurants, nightclubs, sports events, churches, all of these are public spaces, and we cannot erect a security perimeter around every public space. First of all, it's disruptive, it's costly, Moreover, there's very little net security benefit in that. Suppose we were to ring all of the shopping malls with security, all of the restaurants, all of the nightclubs. What would we achieve in doing? We will force the terrorists to drive another few blocks to another public place. If someone, it's not that, oh, well, there's a perimeter there. If I'm a determined terrorist, I can't get through. I'm not going to be a terrorist anymore. No, they will find a place to do this. The other thing is that checkpoints create queues of people that then become targets of terrorists. So we saw at the Istanbul airport, they did extend the perimeter to the airport itself, and that's where the attack took place. But you raise the broader question of Schengen and borders. The European countries are still having great difficulty sharing intelligence and cooperating against terrorism. Despite the EU, which has achieved in a great deal of coordination in other areas, intelligence and law enforcement are still bastions of national sovereignty. And it has been very, very difficult for them to, given their different philosophies, different policies, to come to sharing arrangements there. The problem is, however, is that within Schengen, we have free movement of people. And my view of that is, and I wrote this some time ago, is that either the cooperation is going to go up or the border controls are going to come back. You cannot have an absence of coordination in terms of intelligence and law enforcement dealing with terrorism. On the one hand, a lack, but completely open movement on the other hand. That would be in the United States as if we were try to combat terrorism with 50 little FBIs that didn't talk to each other.
No, it's very true that there needs to be more discussion and sharing of intelligence, specifically in Europe. In the situation, just to go back just a moment into your previous answer about the checkpoints and the need for perimeters and how costly it could be in the cost-benefit analysis when looking at it, something that always seems to come up is always using the Israeli model. But here we see in Israel that there are security guards at every mall. There's one at almost every restaurant. And it doesn't necessarily actually prevent the attacks. It sometimes actually changes where the attack's going to be, as we saw with the Park Hotel bombing in 2002. That wasn't the original location. The suicide bomber decided there isn't enough security there, and there's a lot of people gathering. We'll go there because his original target was unreachable at the end of the day.
Right.
When looking at that, where is, I guess, the balance between where in Israel we have a guard at every restaurant, at every doorway, to where you go to certain locations, Europe and the United States, where there isn't even a security guard around anywhere? Where's the balance?
It's difficult to say precisely where is the balance. I mean, certainly there have been proposals to, for example, implement security measures for surface transportation, modeled on those we have in place for aviation. When we look at that, that turns out to be in a nation of 320 million people. I mean, it's tough enough to do this at 450 airports in the United States. And this you have to keep in mind here that certain things Israel can do because of the size of the nation, mm-hmm. and the nature of the population. And the assessment of the threat that cannot easily be done, because one of the asymmetries here that give the terrorists an advantage is that in response to one attack at one location, for example, that requires, you know, let's say at an airport, if we implement a new measure, then we have to implement that measure at 450 commercial airports across the country. So the costs of the response are not determined by the single attack at a single location, but by the number of targets and the size of those targets to be protected. So in the case of the underwear bomber, the this young man, Abu Mutalib, who had a bomb concealed in his underwear. In response to that, we deployed full body scanners at airports. But this is automatically a cost of an initial capital investment of hundreds of millions of dollars. Mm-hmm. So one bomb and one airplane ticket, which probably cost them a few thousand dollars, results in our spending hundreds of millions of dollars. Now, if that is your continued exchange rate, we lose.
Go bankrupt eventually.
Right.
And to your point on the Schengen and the need for sharing of intelligence and because of the porous borders right now, you were mentioning when you look at the Charlie Hebdo attack in France, you had the two brothers that were being watched. They were known to be in Yemen. We have in the United States the Orlando massacre. Omar Mateen was also being watched by the FBI at certain points in his life. What makes these people, I guess, evade the authorities after a certain amount of time?
It's not that they consciously evade the authorities. The Kouachi brothers were under surveillance, indeed, for several years. And then the surveillance was ended for them because those resources were reallocated. The French right now in particular are dealing with a problem, but it's a problem for all authorities everywhere, and that is a problem of volume. If we total up all of those who have gone from France to Syria, some of whom have returned, or other places, Yemen, or where mm-hmm. where one of the Kouachi brothers went, if we add to that total those who are suspected of planning to go, plus those who have not gone but are being watched as potential homegrown terrorists, in France we get up into the thousands. Now, keeping that many people under surveillance is a major drain on resources. It takes a lot of resources. And so the idea is you have to allocate those resources where you think the threat is going to be great. So the Kouachi brothers hadn't done anything. And so somebody said, look, we have other more imminent threats according to our judgment, and therefore we are reallocating those resources. Sometimes, as in the case of the Omar Mateen, the Orlando shooter, he comes to the attention of the authorities. The authorities interview him, and they decide at the time that he is not an imminent threat. And at the time, that may be correct. However, the problem we deal with there's two issues. One is it is extremely difficult to predict dangerousness, especially over a longer period of time. I mean, psychologists will tell you this is extremely difficult to do. Second, if we look at the career trajectories of a number of these people, there is persistence over a long period of time. I mean, the Kouachi brothers were on the radar of the French authorities for 10 years as criminals, as radicals. They were in jail. They were out of jail. So that persistence over time, but the difficulty of predicting dangerousness means that sometimes we're going to get it wrong. We're going to miss something. And this is why, quite frankly, I liken it to, I know the term lone wolf is au courant in the news media. I despise the term. And I say, look, this is like a pack of stray dogs, and they're all barking and snarling and growling, and you look at them and they dart in and out, and you say, which one is going to bite? That's a tough call.
In your response and in other recent articles that you wrote, it seems that a major theme here is travel, whether how they come in, how they leave, and there were terrorists that were able to return from Syria and back to Europe, back and forth multiple times. Why isn't it possible for European or U.S. governments to make travel to and from Syria illegal, like they did with Iran after the 1979 revolution?
In the United States, in fact, if one is going to Syria, even intends to go to Syria, you don't have to actually get there, but intends to go to Syria for the purposes of joining one of these jihadist groups, that is a crime in the United States. That is material assistance to a terrorist organization, and it's a tough sentence. And we have intercepted a number of individuals on their way, and we have charged and convicted them for providing material assistance. Those returning from Syria are automatically considered criminals, and that is, upon return, they would be promptly arrested. In Europe, it is different. The Europeans have not, well, it varies from European country to European country, but generally have not criminalized providing material support insofar as simply going there. And in terms of their return, therefore, they are not automatically criminals until they do something. And indeed, even then, in trying to charge them and coming back and saying, well, they were members of Jabhat al-Nusra or the Islamic State or something like that, it is a difficult prosecution that they have to make in a courtroom, because they actually need courtroom quality evidence to testify that, yes, this individual was there and did commit a crime. In the United States, we don't operate under that kind of extreme constraints.
So you think it's a legislation issue then? The current legislation that we have is not adequate enough to counter the terrorist threat when it's geared more towards criminals?
In Europe, it is inadequate. There's no question that the laws are inadequate. And the difficulty is that different European countries have different philosophies on how this problem should be approached, and this inhibits their cooperation with one another. For example, in some places, they say that, well, we really should welcome the return of these individuals and try to rehabilitate them, bring them back into society, or in my view, I'd say, well, first we have to rehumanize them. In other places, they say, no, we are going to treat them as suspects and keep them under surveillance. In a few places, they're going to say, no, we're going to arrest them and then figure out if they represent a threat or not. So you have different views of this. Because you have these different views, the governments therefore find it difficult to share some information, because they have completely different approaches. Now, I don't want to overstate that, because what is interesting is that it is difficult for the Europeans to share at the EU level. That is, when you share at the EU level, you're automatically sharing all this information with all of the members of the EU. Separate from the EU structures for counterterrorism and Europol, the European police effort, there is the Club of Bern agreement, which is outside of the EU, more informal, and it's a mechanism that if I am, say, a French intelligence official and I have something of interest and I need some more information, and you are a representative from, say, German or Italian, you and I can exchange information through the Club of Bern, but without engaging this larger body of all 28 members of the EU. And so Club of Bern works. The formal EU mechanism is inhibited.
It's very interesting that you bring that up, because something we hear Dr. Ghannour say all the time is there is a need for an internationally recognized definition of terrorism. And in your opinion, how does that actually work in helping combat terrorism?
If you go back to the early days, there have been struggles over the last 40 some years to try to come up with a definition of terrorism. And the problem is not that we don't have a definition, it's that we have hundreds of definitions of terrorism. And the approach that was taken in the 1970s, when we realized that it was going to be impossible to define terrorism overall, was instead to take a kind of salami slicing strategy and to say we cannot define terrorism, but we can define individual actions where we can get international agreement. So we could, for example, get international consensus on hijacking airliners. And that was led to international conventions. We could get an international consensus and therefore agreement on sabotage of airliners. Not surprisingly, we could get all of the diplomats of the world to agree that diplomats ought not to be targets of terrorism. Another convention. So target by target, tactic by tactic, it took us about 25 years, but we did get a regime of 13 international conventions, none of which defined terrorism, but collectively identified about 90% of what terrorists did. And that was about as good as it was going to get. And that was helpful in eliciting cooperation from many governments. Now, the fact that there's an international convention alone is not going to end terrorism. You take the international convention and roll it up in a tight ball and throw it at the terrorists, and it's not going to stop them. But it was useful. And to the extent that these countries recognize a mutual threat, they will cooperate. Indeed, one of the, less noticed but remarkable developments since 9/11 is the unprecedented cooperation overall between among intelligence services and law enforcement organizations worldwide. Now, as I say, there are still problems within Europe. There are problems elsewhere. I agreed with Boaz Gnor. It would be better if we had, a statute that was equally applied throughout the world. I may be a bit more cynical that we're probably not going to get that so long, again, as we have these deep differences about how to deal with this problem, deep differences about the origins of terrorism, how to deal with it. These are fundamental philosophical differences. And those philosophical arguments, although terrorism has changed and counterterrorism has evolved, these fundamental philosophical arguments, balance between liberties and security, issues between privacy and needs of intelligence, dealing with hostage situations, preventing radicalization, de-radicalization, these are fundamental arguments that continue to this day.
And speaking about rhetoric, for many years you mentioned in your MTI report that European governments have discounted the terrorist threat, and because of that, they're more unprepared than they would be. We see the same parallels today in the U.S. with the current administration refusing to use the words radical Islam, refusing to talk about the subject in a manner like that. If you were an Obama advisor right now, or an advisor for the next administration like you were with Clinton, how would you advise them to change their rhetoric in dealing with this?
Well, first of all, I want to underscore that I am ferociously nonpartisan. It's not my role to get into political rhetoric. There are those in the administration that have great concerns, and this was also a concern under the Bush administration as well, that we don't want our efforts against jihadist terrorist organizations, like Al-Qaeda or its progeny, Jabhat al-Nusra or the Islamic State or others, to slide into being a war on Islam. That would be counterproductive. And so we want to be careful with our rhetoric that we not go down that path. And there are some people who would say, no, this is a battle between, you know, the West or Christianity, Judaism on one side versus Islam on the other. The government wants to avoid that. Now, I have no problem using the word Islamist. I have no problem using the word Islamic radical. I think we're dealing with an ideology. It's not extraterrestrial. I mean, it didn't come from the planet Jupiter. It is a ideology drawn from a religion and reflecting the experience and history of developments in certain societies, and that's the reality. So whatever words are used publicly, they ought not to affect our assessment of the reality of the situation. Second, I think the United States is going through we're not quite there yet, because, you know, you probably should discount all rhetoric in an election year in the United States. I mean, it's political rhetoric. And there's a lot of podium pounding and fist smacking and finger wagging. Easy to do. Once you're actually in office, things become a lot more complicated. And the reality is, on the one hand, clearly the threat continues. A president who came into office determined to withdraw our forces from Iraq and Afghanistan and get out of these wars is, in fact, going to hand off a war in Afghanistan to his successor, whoever that may be. And we are currently bombing targets in Iraq and Syria. And this president has stepped up to an unprecedented level. Drone strikes against terrorist leaders, not just in these conflict zones, but elsewhere in Yemen, in Somalia, and Pakistan, and elsewhere. So they, in many respects, they've stepped up the fight. But the dilemma we face right now is a question on the part of the American people who are a bit weary. These have turned out to be the longest wars in American history. They have not been the costliest in terms of human lives, fortunately. We have about 7,000 to 8,000 soldiers who have been killed in Afghanistan and in Iraq. Fortunately, that's only a small portion of the 58,000 fatalities we had in Vietnam, or the 400,000 fatalities we had in World War II. They have been costly in terms of treasure. Estimates overall, perhaps somewhere in the area of $4 to $6 trillion. But here's the real question, and the question is, does the homeland security in the United States, does the safety of every American depend on continued perpetual warfare in places like Syria, Iraq, Afghanistan, and elsewhere? In other words, are we in the same position that, you know, the ancient Romans were, and that is the safety of Rome depended on the legions perpetually at war on the frontiers of the Roman Empire? It is an uncomfortable thought, but perhaps the reality is that we shouldn't think of terrorism in terms of a war, which in westernized, by the way, is a finite undertaking. In the eyes of our adversaries, there's nothing finite about it. As bin Laden said, this clash began centuries ago and will continue to Judgment Day. Or Khalid Sheikh Mohammed, the planner of 9/11, said it even more succinctly, war is life. Now, that's what we're dealing with on the other side. And so perhaps, however, we will be forced into say, yes, this is an ongoing effort closer conceptually to law enforcement, in the sense that while we use military force, in the case of law enforcement, we have no illusion that the police will ultimately defeat crime and then we can withdraw the police and not have police anymore. It may be that we have to say the world is going to have a certain volume of terrorism. We can try to contain it, reduce it, degrade their operational capabilities so they can't hurt us in a significant way. But this goes on.
So then at what point do you see a real change in the mindset in needing to combat this? Because as of right now, it seems that at least society and government, on the government side, you see it as this is a war. When you hear people like Bin Laden or KSM come out and say that's a perpetual war, this is for centuries, this is till the end of time, our life is war, as you said. At this point, do you not need to match that type of rhetoric to defeat that type of rhetoric? To be on the battlefield against an enemy that is going at all costs, there needs to be a similar mentality? Or is that an old type of thinking that needs to be changed anyway?
No, I think you know, look, going back to 9/11, I argued immediately after 9/11 that... and of course, I have to point out here, I'm at a disadvantage in dealing with politicians because I write down the things I say, and therefore I have to answer for them. It's not just rhetoric that I can say, well, I didn't say that or I didn't mean that. No, it's in writing, and so I'm stuck with it. But right after 9/11, I argued that this time must be different, that this time has to be a war. Now, what did I mean by that, a war? I meant that previously we had used military force in response to terrorism. The terrorists would attack us. We would strike back, and then we'd wait. And then the terrorists would strike again, and we would strike back, and then we'd wait. That's not deterrence. It's building a relationship. And so instead, I argued that this time it has to be our goal to destroy this group. I was the Senator Cato of counterterrorism. Senator Cato was in the ancient Roman Senate, and he concluded every single speech, whether he's talking about the price of grain or the water system in Rome, with, and furthermore, Carthage must be destroyed, the enemy of Rome. And I would be happy to say, and furthermore, Al-Qaeda, those responsible for 9/11, must be destroyed. Now, that could take us 150 years. Didn't bother me. That's what it will take, and we will do it. I realized that we were going to, that this would be a long contest. We were going to use military force. Military force was not going to be the only thing we were going to use. There was going to be law enforcement where appropriate, intelligence, diplomacy, propaganda, everything we could muster. But military force was going to be part of it. That we had to mobilize national resources to do it, and a war is the way in which you do it. And perhaps it's because I carry some baggage as a Vietnam veteran, I argued that if we are going to send young men into battle, into harm's way, in today's world, young men and young women into battle, then we could only do so with a formal expression of support by the American people through their elected representatives. So I wanted a declaration of war, or if not a declaration of war, its equivalent. That is an expression by Congress that this is what we're going to do. And it turned out to be an authorization for the use of military force. That's what it's called. And it says we will go after the Taliban and Al-Qaeda and we will destroy them. And now, what I didn't realize at the time is, of course, in the eyes of my fellow Americans, the minute we have a war, then a clock starts ticking, and people say, well, how long is this war going to take? Because all of the other wars ended with somebody coming out on the decks of a battleship and signing a surrender document or something like that. And I didn't think that was going to occur, and perhaps by the use of the term war, set up some false expectations. I testified before the Armed Services Committee of the Senate in December 2001, 3 months after 9/11. And a senator asked me, he said, Mr. Jenkins, it's been 90 days since 9/11, and nothing has happened. Are we through it yet? Now, I think I gave a smart aleck answer that this wasn't some episode of West Wing, that this was a question that they could ask me 10 years from now, 15 years from now, 20 years, and we might see where we are. Suppose with more prescience than I had then, I had actually correctly forecast that 15 years from now, we're coming up to the 15th year anniversary of 9/11, we will still be at it. That would be a depressing thought, even though we anticipated it could easily go that long. The good news, there were no more attacks of 9/11 scale, which was our principal concern right after 9/11. Is there, how many more 9/11s are there in the pipeline? And so we better do something fast to stop that. There have been no more of those. That's been a success. In fact, if I had said then, which turns out to be accurate, that since 9/11 in the United States, 89 people, I don't want to say only 89 people because every death is tragic, but 89 people over a 15-year period have been killed by jihadist terrorists in the United States. Now, would they say, oh, that's a positive development, that's good, we have done well, but they'd be depressed by the fact that in order to achieve that, as I say, it's taken us 15 years. I don't know if we're at the halfway point in this war. I can't say that. In the 30 years war, I don't know if in 1633, the Kingdom of Bohemia knew it was a halfway point. This will go on. This president will hand off this war, this, no, we don't use that term anymore, but will hand off this war, this effort to his successor. I suspect that they will be handing it off to their successors. So I expect this to go on for a long time.
Do you expect a final moment in this conflict at the end of the day? Because as you said, all these other wars have ended with someone surrendering on the deck of a ship. But, you know, you don't see that with an Osama bin Laden type. You don't see Baghdadi going to be showing up on the USS whatever to sign an agreement that the ISIS has done. So what is the end result if it is in 15 years, 20 years, 40 years down the line? What do you see as the actual end result?
Well, I mean, bin Laden is dead, and I'll accept right. that as a reasonable substitute for signing a surrender document.
100%.
And if the other leaders of al-Qaeda who are still at large join him, along with Baghdad and the others, I'll accept that as well. In that sense, I think we have to be realistic. There will, with these individuals, be no surrender document, nor are there likely to be any negotiations ending this as well. There's nothing really to negotiate on either side here. So this, in a sense, is a fight to the end. How long that fight will take is... I don't know. I'm not nationally recognized in the field of prophecy. But could it go on for decades? Yes, we've seen contests. We've seen contests go on for decades. This easily could. Will it morph, evolve, change, as it already has? I mean, in the wake of 9/11, we were dealing with al-Qaeda. We're now dealing with al-Qaeda and a bunch of little franchises and some homegrown guys. We're also dealing with an offshoot of al-Qaeda, the Islamic State, and a bunch of discontents, in fact, some of whom are mentally disordered, who just before the attack, you know, put on an ISIS T-shirt. So it has evolved, it has dispersed, it has changed in a lot of ways. I suspect, looking ahead over the next 15 years, that will continue to be the case. And so the form will change, the evolution will continue, but realistically, I think, not that I'm predicting that the fight will go on, but I think it has to be our operational presumption that it could.
Why couldn't there be any negotiations? I mean, we recently took a class that said that all governments negotiate with terrorists, and in fact, it actually works often to negotiate with terrorists in the release of hostages and other events. Isn't it possible to negotiate with some of these terrorist groups a ceasefire or something like that just while we work on a solution?
I agree. In fact, I'm the co-author of a report saying that, look, we should not exclude the possibility ultimately of negotiations. I think realistically that may be possible with the Taliban. Is it realistically possible with Al-Qaeda's leadership or with Baghdadi and the Islamic State? I don't see that as being realistic right now. So in principle, I'm not going to say never, but I just don't see it as realistic. Now, we have a recent development, which is fascinating, and we're trying to understand what does this mean. And that is, we have seen Jabhat al-Nusra announce its separation from Al-Qaeda. Now, this is not a defiant divorce, as in the case of Baghdadi and ISIS leaving the Al-Qaeda constellation. This is, in my view, a name change that will facilitate Jabhat al-Nusra's entry into and creation of a broader coalition that may in the future hope to play some kind of political role in governing a Sunni entity in a post-Assad Syria. We shall see. And it may even open up an opportunity for us to say, all right, is this a way of resolving this component of it while we focus our activities on ISIS? That may be the case. But now, in saying that, I have to admit I'm talking like some tribal sheikh where there are no principles. There are only Byzantine maneuvers and complicated arabesques to ensure survival.
You were mentioning how the nature of terrorism has changed, the evolution of terrorism over time has changed, and with that has also changed the technological forms of communications around the world, be it internet, cell phones, all types of communications have evolved as well. And through that, we have also seen now a real connection between groups around the globe. Whereas we knew there was terrorism around the globe at all times, we're now seeing it, more clearly now, the connections you see with Boko Haram or different groups get up and declare allegiance to Al-Qaeda or to ISIS or whoever it may be. One thing we have seen now of recent years over the last couple decades has been a nexus between extreme criminal organizations and terrorist organizations. And I know you've spent quite a bit of time in Latin America, studied both in Mexico and Guatemala. We are now seeing specifically Hezbollah working alongside quite a few of the cartels, Mexican border and south. What kind of a danger is that to the United States right now?
There is a danger. I mean, there's several things going on at once. This is a complicated phenomenon, but there are purely criminal groups. That is, groups simply determined to operate for profit, who are adopting terrorist tactics. So we see cartels in Mexico using beheadings and car bombs and things like this and elsewhere in Latin America. So criminal groups adopting terrorist tactics. We see terrorist groups, groups that use terrorist tactics, engaging in criminal activities to fund themselves. So whether it's Hezbollah engaging in drug production or smuggling or counterfeit pharmaceuticals, that is one aspect, or if it is, Colombia's guerrillas engaging in the cocaine traffic. So that is also taking place at the same time. And then we see something at a lower level, but nonetheless important in Europe. You know, looking at a lot of these fellows that were involved in this network that was responsible for the attacks in Paris and the attacks last March in Brussels. This was part of a continuing campaign by a network of guys. Some of them went to Syria, some of them did not. A lot of them have petty criminal backgrounds. They come out of a subculture that transcends the world of crime, the criminal underworld, and the radicalized underground. And so that's a different aspect of the phenomenon. So we see these connections taking place. But you mentioned the importance of technology, the importance in particular of communications. To be sure, the origins of contemporary terrorism, I mean, we can find examples of terrorism in the Bible, you know, but of contemporary terrorism clearly reflected not only political circumstances but technological developments. And one of the most important technological developments were the developments in communications, radio, television, communication, satellites, the kinds of things that made it possible to broadcast almost instantaneously throughout the world these dramatic incidents of violence that terrorists choreographed in order to attract the attention of a global audience. And they exploited that. In looking, now again, looking back at things I wrote in the past, you know, we were engaged in an effort in the late 1970s to say, okay, what would be the weapons that terrorists might use in the future? What would their arsenal look like in the future? And we missed the most important one. The internet is both a vulnerability and a weapon. And we have seen our terrorist adversaries effectively exploit that for propaganda purposes, for recruiting, for instigating terrorist attacks abroad. And indeed, probably the most dramatic recent change is the very effective use by ISIS of social media to directly reach an audience. I mean, Al-Qaeda's communications were more centralized and sure over the years have become more professional, from shaky handheld cameras to things that look like CNN sets with a crawl at the bottom and symbols on the side. But it's still centralized communications, and in fact, Zawahiri's speeches are boring. Talks like a political commissar. But the social media stuff is reaching a broader audience and in a form that, and given my generation, is a little bit difficult for us to understand something. What does hashtag mean, you know? But is a readily understood both mode of communication and style of speech that is directly accessible to a much broader audience. And that clearly has had an effect in attracting a lot of young people to the Islamic State in their recruitment and in their inspiration. Now, at the same time, it has done something else. And here we're kind of right on the edge of trying to figure out what's going on here. If we look at a lot of these recent attacks, they're carried out by people who are really troubled individuals. I mean, people with histories of mental disorders, substance abuse, arrest for aggression, and so on. And so our question is here, has this ideology become a conveyor for individual discontents in which the ideology is only a thin veneer because it resonates with individuals who it may in fact be incorrect to call them radicalized. These are angry, troubled individuals, already violent, not put off by the Islamic State's advertisement of atrocity, but in fact attracted and excited by it. And so we're seeing a crossover between, in a sense, ideology and mental disorder.
Part of the reason these people are so angry and so willing to latch on to those values is possibly because there's a clash of cultures between these new immigrants and the arrivals into Europe. They're either unemployed or receiving menial jobs. They don't speak the same language. They don't speak the same culture. At the same time, we see Persian Gulf states like Kuwait, Oman, Qatar, UAE, these rich, rich states that have accepted zero Syrian refugees. Do you think that the Persian Gulf can play a bigger role in helping to mitigate the crisis? And do you think that the U.S. and the European governments should put more pressure on these Persian Gulf states in order to do so?
Well, first, yes, they can play a greater role. Second, the United States and the European countries have put pressure on them. It has not been as effective as I suppose most would want or expect. It may, in fact, be changing. I mean, we are approaching. We've certainly seen it already in the UAE. We are seeing it in Saudi Arabia, a younger generation of leaders who believe that some fundamental transformations, economic transformations, perhaps political transformations, although certainly that has to be a more discrete element of what they're saying, but that fundamental transformation is necessary. If for no other reason than the fact that because of other technological developments, their monopoly or dominant role in oil supplies to the West has been reduced. I mean, because of fracking and other things, although that raises environmental concerns, you know, at $30 and $40 a barrel, we can frack profitably. And that changes things dramatically. And people are looking at it and saying, you know, in whether you're in Riyadh or elsewhere, we cannot depend on the fact that we sit on top of big oil reserves as a guarantee that we can, you know, that the West can push or that we are vital. Probably another component of that is, you know, the regional competition between Iran on the one hand and these Sunni Gulf kingdoms on the others. And so there are some dramatic changes taking place which we've only begun to see glimpses of. And one is never quite sure. You can be cynical and say, okay, a Saudi initiative to create a military alliance against Islamic extremism, a word they use is Islamic extremism. And by that they mean the Islamic State. Is that merely a PR thing to polish up their image? Possibly so. Or do they see that as a way of mobilizing their populations to go after it, which in turn, it is predictable, will create pressures to perhaps reduce or sever some of the relationships they've had with some of the Wahhabi elements? We don't know. But there are opportunities for us not simply to in a sense, wag our fingers and pound on people's head and say, you must do this, which turns out to be never particularly effective diplomacy anyway, but rather to engage and shape in a much more subtle fashion some of these things. You see that even going on. I mean, there was recently here in Israel a Saudi delegation that came to Israel. 10 years ago, that would have been unheard of, unthinkable. So things are happening right now. Changes will take place. And we can dismiss them, or we can say there's some interesting possibilities here. How can we exploit it to our advantage?
We are running out of time here, so I just want to get down to one final question before we let you go, Mr. Jenkins, and that is to do with the chemical, biological, and nuclear potential for terrorists, especially now in an age where we have Iran proliferating with what they're doing, regardless of an agreement or not. We know that there is enrichment of uranium happening. That type of technology may not be in the sense of a massive bomb that can be dropped from the air, but it could be a suitcase radioactive bomb, a dirty bomb of some sort. With the fall or potential fall of Assad and his chemical weapons that he has, those could definitely fall into Hezbollah hands, into Al-Qaeda hands, into any one of the groups operating there. What type of fear should we have about the WMDs, obviously on a lesser scale than a state having WMDs, but nonetheless, WMDs in the hands of terrorists?
It's a continuing concern, and we have to address each of these separately. And because one of the problems with the term, you know, WMD, weapons of mass destruction, is you tend to aggregate them in a pile. And chemical is not the same as biological, is not the same as nuclear. Chemical... certainly, we have seen terrorists use that, albeit not as an effective way, but they have done that. In biological, they have dabbled at the edges of that, not in a particularly effective way, and there may be some self-imposed constraints there. I mean, people worry about the deliberate dissemination of contagious diseases. And there's no question something like smallpox or something like that, where somebody to get a hold of a strain and spread it through the West would cause casualties. Our public health systems would deal with it. But when it came around the world fast as it would and hit Karachi and Cairo, then there really would be massive deaths. So there may be some constraints there. In terms of radiological, unless one has vast quantities, you know, the so-called dirty bomb, it is the explosion that will kill the people. The radioactivity will be less of an issue unless there are massive quantities. As the world goes gradually toward nuclear weapons, clandestine nuclear weapons, we risk more things like AQCON, you know, clandestine networks to disseminate this technology. And that increases our risk. So it clearly is a risk. Now, I don't want to exaggerate it. It's you know, it doesn't mean we spend the rest of our lives under the kitchen table here. And probably compared to the risks we confronted during the Cold War, when there were tens of thousands of nuclear missiles pointed at us and tens of thousands pointed the other way, that was real. But I think we've fairly well established that certainly the United States will take whatever action it deems necessary, including unilateral preemptive military action, to prevent terrorists from acquiring or using weapons, a nuclear weapon. And I think that is an important declaration to have there. I don't necessarily have confidence that it will deter every single actor, so we will do what we can with intelligence, with increasing security around nuclear facilities, preventing proliferation, and doing a lot of other things to keep this stuff from getting into the wrong hands. But it is a continuing concern.
Mr. Jenkins, thank you so much for taking the time out of your busy schedule to sit with us here in our IDC studios. We really appreciate you taking the time. And just for our audience out there that want to have more understanding and get more enlightenment on this subject, where can our audience go and find your books, your articles?
Most of it can be found at rand.org. And if you go to rand.org and simply put in my last name, then that will pop up, and a long, a nauseating list of publications will come up, and you can read those. Also, there is a website for the Mineta, that's as in M-I-N-E-T-A, the Mineta Transportation Institute. And there again, if you go to that website and go through the clicks, another body of research will come up. And then finally, there is a BrianMichaelJenkins.com website, and another set of publications will come up. So it's just about 95% of it is available on the internet.
Excellent stuff. We look forward to continuing to research and read it, and definitely looking forward to your class here that you are teaching at the IDC. Mr. Jenkins, thank you so much for joining us here in our studios. We wish you the best on the rest of your trip.
Thank you for the opportunity.
Well.
Thank you.
Thank you.